If you prefer to remain seated, that's fine with us.
Yes, Your Honors, I have a medical condition which makes it difficult.
We understand.
Thank you, Your Honors.
Place that microphone closer to you so we can hear you well. Better.
And turn it on.
Yes.
Much better. Okay. Thank you, Your Honors. May it please the court, my name is Moselle Leland, and I'm representing Herman Evans IV this morning in his Social Security disability claims. And I'd like to reserve about 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Okay. Can you see the clock from there?
Yes, I can.
Okay.
Your Honors, this case turns on two issues. First, the ALJ improperly rejected the treating and examining sources' opinions. And second, the ALJ improperly rejected the claimant's complaints of pain and subjective complaints.
Would you repeat that, please?
That the ALJ improperly rejected the claimant's subjective complaints or credibility. And based on these two reasons, this court should remand for a calculation of benefits.
There's a textual issue I'd like to take up with you.
Yes.
You said the plaintiff's...
I'm sorry, the claimant's.
The claimant's objective complaints?
No, subjective.
Subjective complaints.
Okay, that's... Subjective. I'll try to speak more clearly. And based on these reasons, I believe this case should be remanded for a calculation of benefits without further proceedings as it meets the Garrison standard. With regards to medical opinions, this court reaffirmed the importance of the treating physician's opinion last year in the case of Treviso versus Berryhill. And in that case, this court held that it was reversible error for the ALJ to fail to properly consider the factors set forth in 20 CFR 404.1527C. Like the Treviso case, the ALJ in this case also failed to properly consider those factors. And also like Treviso, the claimant in this case, Mr. Evans, had a lengthy and extensive treatment relationship with his treating orthopedist, Dr. Schwartz, that spanned nearly 6 years. He was seen monthly or almost monthly for more than 60 visits. And on nearly every visit, Dr. Schwartz documented complaints of severe pain as well as objective findings.
Documented complaints of severe pain.
Yes, Your Honor.
Right.
Which is a part of the...
Let's get right to what I think is important in this case. You can't disregard... The ALJ can't disregard the treating physician without pointing to objective medical evidence which contradicts the conclusion, correct?
Correct, Your Honor.
All right. How do you handle the computer-assisted tomograms, the CTs, which is a precise measure, much more precise than standard x-rays, and which find the back, quote, unremarkable, with no signs of degenerative disease and well-maintained disc spaces? Dr. Lorber at the ALJ hearing used it to rebut the 2009 MRI, rebulging disc and narrow L5S1, and said he's not a candidate for surgery. Lorber found that he could do light work, and the cane that he was carrying around was not required. Now, that is objective medical evidence in the record, which the ALJ used to rebut Dr. Schwartz and Dr. Hasday. Right? Isn't that all he has to do?
Well, Your Honor, the CT scan did show evidence of spasm, although it did show it was unremarkable in other respects. And also, I could provide supplemental documentation, but a CT scan might not show everything that an MRI shows. And the MRI did show degenerative disc disease and facet hypertrophy. So there was evidence.
There's contradictory evidence as to whether there was degenerative disc disease. And the ALJ chose the CT scan rather than the MRI. Error?
Perhaps there was contradictory. Perhaps there was contradictory evidence, but I do. There still was evidence of spasm on the CT scan, so there was evidence that something was there.
Wait a minute. A CT scan is a X-ray.
Correct.
And you say it shows spasm? That's muscle.
Correct.
Muscle doesn't show on an X-ray. So how does a CT scan show spasm?
I'd have to look at that further to provide a better answer, Your Honor.
Please don't let me interrupt you anymore. Go ahead with your presentation.
Sure. But, Your Honors, I'd also like to discuss the fact that a lot of the ALJ's reasons for rejecting Dr. Schwartz's opinion didn't meet the Lester-specific and legitimate reason standard, such as a lack of aggressive treatment. And that simply isn't true. He was provided with high-dose narcotic medications, muscle relaxers, an anti-seizure medication, and antidepressants. And even Dr. Lorber, the medical expert, conceded that high-dose narcotic medications would cause significant side effects. So I can't see how this would be considered conservative in nature. It's not like he's taking over-the-counter medications. Also, assuming that aggressive treatment was not provided or recommended, this court held in Treviso that that would not be a legitimate reason to discount the treating physician's opinion. And the ALJ also concluded that more aggressive treatment was not recommended, and this was in fact a mistake, as epidurals and a surgical consult were recommended, but Mr. Evans chose not to pursue those due to his fears of negative consequences. And I'd point you to the regulations at 404.1530. An individual is not obligated to undergo invasive treatment, and also the rulings at 8259. State that an individual's intense and unusual fear may be a justifiable reason to not pursue more aggressive treatment. With regards to the consultative evaluator hired by the agency to conduct an evaluation, Dr. Bill Azikshian, the ALJ also improperly rejected that opinion. That opinion stated that Mr. Evans would not be able to engage in any substantial gainful activity. And the ALJ rejected this opinion, saying that it merely reflected subjective complaints and the clinical picture. And Dr. Bill Azikshian did, in fact, document objective findings on exam.
The ALJ made some adverse credibility determinations as to your client.
Yes, Your Honor.
Are they without basis?
For instance,
made the determination the complaints are inconsistent with the low objective evidence of injury or disease, that the unchanging and conservative treatment was inconsistent with the serious injury, which you discussed, and he exaggerated symptoms such as being bedridden, urination in a bedpan, and barely able to hold a glass account of the pain. This is a man with back pain, and he can barely hold a glass because of pain. That's one of his. The ALJ is not justified in finding that to be an exaggerated symptom?
I would say not, Your Honor. As Dr. Nahaman, the psychologist who conducted psychological testing, found, Mr. Evans was not exaggerating or embellishing his symptoms and was, in fact, credible. Based on this testing, he may have perhaps had a somatization, which might appear to be an exaggeration, but is not, in fact, exaggeration. And that's a different issue. That's more of a psychiatric condition. But that doesn't mean that he is malingering or that he is exaggerating his symptoms. And psychological testing document that he, in fact, was not. And also, this court held in Bunnell versus Sullivan that once objective evidence of a condition is presented, the ALJ can't reject it simply because there is a lack of more significant objective findings, as pain, symptoms can suggest a greater level of impairment than can be shown by objective medical evidence. And pain is subjective.
Credible.
Well, and I would argue that he is credible, and Dr. Nahaman's testing shows that he's a credible individual.
But whether you argue whether he's credible or whether we believe he's credible, the question is whether the ALJ had substantial evidence to find against his credibility.
Well, and I don't believe he did, as the case law indicates that just because there is mild clinical findings, that doesn't mean that an individual's complaint should be rejected.
All right.
Also, you know, I discussed the conservative treatment. I don't see how narcotics could be considered conservative. This is not like PARA, where the claimant was taking over-the-counter medications. And also, the ALJ held that Mr. Evans was not credible because he did not need a cane. I think this is the ALJ really playing doctor, because the treating and examining physician, Dr. Bilazikian and Dr. Schwartz, both agreed that Mr. Evans did require a cane. And so, Your Honor, there is no affirmative evidence of malingering in this case. Therefore, the judge should have provided clear and convincing reasons, and we argue that these were not clear and convincing reasons to do so.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, counsel.
Good morning, Your Honor. Shea Bond on behalf of the Acting Commissioner of Social Security. I think this case boils down to the plaintiff really as asking this court to reweigh the evidence that the ALJ already properly weighed, and that there is ample, more than substantial evidence that supports the ALJ's conclusions in this case, for weighing the opinion evidence the way that she did and for finding the claimant's allegations less than fully credible. There is a real disparity between the claimant's allegations and the extent of those allegations of back pain. And as Your Honor was mentioning, the claimant is alleging he is bedridden, that he cannot get out of bed for almost any reason, he can't function during the day. And so he is making the allegation that he is the proverbial claimant vegetating in the dark corner, that he can't get up and do anything. And yet the objective findings in this case just simply don't support the level of those allegations. The neurological functioning has routinely been documented as unremarkable and normal in muscle strength, sensation, and reflexes. And that's going back from the date of the injury in March of 2009 all the way through 2015. And yes, there are a lot of treatment records here, but the claimant was seeking workers' compensation benefits. And so as part of the workers' compensation system, there needs to be periodic reports from the treating physician. And when you look at those periodic reports, the same exact clinical findings are being documented throughout these period of years. The diagnostic test results were unremarkable. They showed at most mild to moderate degenerative changes. The most recent CT scan, as Your Honor pointed out, showed that the lumbar spine was essentially unremarkable.
Yes and no. He has some.
He has some
objective evidence. For instance, he has pain on straight leg raising in the left leg. He has cramping and numbness in the dermatome distribution. He has atrophy of the left calf, one centimeter, found by both Schwartz and by Hasday. So he has some objective evidence of nerve root compression due to a bulging disc.
Well, I'm going to disagree with that, because the electrodiagnostic testing that was performed to specifically find that if there was radicular symptoms actually said there were no radicular symptoms from lumbar degeneration into the extremities. Mm-hmm. And the straight leg raise tests are very inconclusive, and that's what Dr. Lorber testified to. And the problem is that when the testing is performed, the claimant complained, and I will agree that there's maybe a couple of instances where the pain not only was in the lower back, but radiated down to the back of the leg. Mm-hmm. But if there isn't that radiation down in the back of the leg, it's not evidence of a nerve root compression. And so the majority of the straight leg raising tests only talked about lower back pain and not the radiating pain. So I'm going to disagree that the diagnostics in combination with the clinical findings consistently showed that there was this kind of radiating pain. The majority of the test results do not document that.
How do you meet your learned friend's position that the mental examination show that there is a somatic reaction, and therefore that the complaints, exaggerated complaints, should be taken with a grain of salt, because of his mental condition?
Well, I don't believe that the claimant had made those allegations before about this as being a somatoform disorder, that I feel like I'm having these symptoms, but there's really no documentation of an objective reason for it. And there's no limitations associated with that somatoform disorder from what Dr. Neham had assessed. So, and no other doctor suggested that the symptoms he was experiencing were based on a mental impairment. He was being treated for, you know, orthopedic and physical conditions. None of the other doctors said that that was the basis. They were basing it on his physical conditions. There is no other support for that in the record.
The claim is made if he exaggerates his symptoms, it's because of some sort of mental condition that he's suffering from, and that's got
right.
to be taken into consideration.
But I'm not seeing that really supported in this record. Again, it's he was basing this on his the orthopedic injury that he experienced in 2009. He wasn't even alleging that he was having any kind of mental problems until his attorney admitted this at the hearing. It wasn't until 2012 that he actually began having these symptoms. So that wouldn't explain, even if we're buying into this theory that this is a psychological basis for him exaggerating symptoms, that doesn't explain what was happening between 2009 and 2012. When he filed his application, there's no allegation of any kind of mental component here at all. And you know, ultimately, you don't have any limitations being assessed by any doctor who treated him for a mental impairment. It was just that the statement was that he was just disabled. There were no limitations associated with that. So I mean, there's nothing in this record saying that this claimant has a severe mental impairment that is causing all of these other symptoms to occur.
Well, but Dr. Schwartz and Dr. Haas, they both give him disability, don't they?
They assessed him as disabled, but that's the opinion of disability that's supposed to be reserved to the commissioner. A disability opinion, especially in the context of another governmental organization's program, is not binding on the agency. And the ALJ went forth and also assessed the limitations that these doctors assess and said there is no objective basis for it. We have consistent, fairly unremarkable and normal findings. The negative clinicals that are documented are very few and far between, and they're not what would be expected for, again, if we're looking at the allegations that the claimant is making, that there's just a huge disparity. You would expect that on examination, and if you look at Dr. Schwartz's later treatment records from 2013 to 2014, the claimant's alleging he has 10 out of 10 pain, which is the most excruciating pain that anybody could imagine. And then during the examination, Dr. Schwartz is palpating the muscles along the spine, and the only response he can elicit is just tenderness, not exquisite tenderness, not I'm crying in pain or, you know, crumpling on the floor from being touched. The claimant is only demonstrating that I feel tender. And then there's also the absolutely negative, normal motor and sensory and reflex findings for years and years. So yes, there are some negative you know, diagnostic test results and clinical findings, but it certainly does not override the substantial evidence that supported the ALJ's analysis. And it's for the ALJ to weigh the inconsistencies and the conflicts and to reach a determination. And that's what the ALJ here. And I feel that claimant really is just asking this court to reweigh the evidence to reach a different conclusion.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Rebuttal?
Yes. With regards to the government's position that there were no limitations provided by the agreed medical expert in psychology, he opined that Mr. Evans would be unable to work. Although he didn't set out specific limitations, he did opine as to that. And with regards to the electrodiagnostic testing, I don't know if the court would appreciate or want, but if I may, I could submit evidence as to what that does and does not show.
Well, we have the record.
Okay. All right, Your Honor. And with regards to the findings, there were, in fact, on multiple occasions, findings of not just pain or tenderness, but weakness in the toes, decreased range of motion, numbness, and so forth. And again, straight leg raising tests were positive on some of the evaluations.
But counselor, as opposing counsel noted, isn't that all for the ALJ to weigh and determine which medical evidence is more persuasive?
The judge is supposed to weigh, but the judge has to have some sort of basis for that, not just the ALJ's own lay opinion. And really, the ALJ was relying on Dr. Lorber.
Didn't the ALJ point to medical evidence in the record?
Yes, Your Honor. Yes, Your Honor. He did. She did.
She
did. But when rejecting a treating or examining physician, you know, the ALJ should have been relying on some opinion, not just looking at the evidence and playing doctor and evaluating that evidence. And she, in this case, the ALJ, relied on Dr. Lorber, and I don't see any contradictory evidence other than Dr. Lorber's opinion. And this court held in Revels that a non-examining opinion cannot constitute substantial evidence on its own. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, thank you. If there's nothing else, thank you to both counsel. The case just argued is submitted for a decision by the court.